We don't know the birthdays of all participants, but there is an exceptional event taking place tomorrow. One of our participants, Yvette Kosmanshvartbach, she will be celebrating not just some arbitrary birthday, but her 80th birthday. Well, probably according to tradition, Yvette, we cannot yet congratulate you properly, but we congratulate you on this coming event. Let's put it this way. So Yvette, all our congratulations and all the best for this very, very welcome. Okay. And maybe the second short announcement next week, as you probably seen, there will be a junior global Poisson event. And maybe Nikita, you just say a couple of words about
yes.
that.
Yeah, so it's we're planning, it's a 4-day workshop fully online, and it's about Poisson geometry and related things. And all of our speakers are junior speakers, PhD and postdocs. So we're sort of highlighting the recent advances by some of the younger members of the community. But of course, everybody's invited. It's kind of the idea is to bring all the Poisson geometry community and focus on the junior members. So there's lots of events. I'll post the link in the chat, so everyone is cordially invited.
Okay, thanks a lot, Nikita. So now it's probably time to start the seminar proper. It's a great pleasure today to have Yakov Ilyashberg, who will be speaking on the space of tight contact structures on R3. So Yasha, I give you the floor.
Okay, thank you very much. And I'm really happy to see many friends here. And I'm apologize that my subject is not very much kind of Poisson, but please ask me question. I'll try I want you to understand that. So this is kind of a little bit too geometric for the audience, but I hope you can ask question and I can explain. Okay, so everything is kind of started for me 30 years ago. I wrote a paper called Contact Three Manifold 20 Years After Martinet Work. And this talk can be entitled 50 Years After, or maybe 20 Years After, 30 Years After this 20 Years. So this paper, I was very excited. I kind of proved several results which I liked, and I maybe was a little bit too optimistic, and I proved some result. And I also was saying that this can be proved by a similar method, and that can be proved by a similar method. And one of this my claim, kind of which was, I said, it can be proved, was indeed proven by Giroux, Honda, Kalen, and it in fact was much more complicated than I imagined in that paper. And another such claim one of the theorem which I proved there was that I will discuss it later, but there is some kind of dichotomy of contact structure on three manifold on tight and over twisted. And what I proved that there exists, there's the only tight contact structure on R3 is a standard one. And my kind of that was proven, but what optimistic, too optimistic statement was that this you can similarly prove that the space of all tight contact structure is in fact contractible of, if say, standard at infinity. And I know that there were some attempt by some people to prove it, and as far as I know, there were no kind of proof appears, correct proof appeared. So and recently, kind of what I was stimulated kind of again to think about this, but that Fran Presses with his students, he started to prove some result using this unproven my result. And so therefore I decided that actually it's already a little bit too long and it should be proven. And then we joined with Nikolai Mishachev and we proved this result now. And that's what I'm going to discuss in this talk. So let me just give you like short introduction to quantum geometry. So this is kind of strange. If you don't know about quantum manifold, of course, you cannot learn from my presentation. But if you know that this is a completely kind of nonsense, what I'm going to talk, it's just very standard. But so please ask me and interrupt me, please be active. So context structure on odd dimensional manifold is a completely non-integrable plane field. And like I will be only consider corrientable case. And in this case is given by globally by one form, which is called context form. And this Frobenius non-integrability condition means that d alpha is on alpha equals zero is in fact a symplectic form, which means alpha raised d alpha to the n is not zero. So the one form alpha is not really part of context structure, it's just defined up to conformance factor. So what is kind of fundamental that all context structure are locally isomorphic and given by Darboux normal form, and even moreover, the form itself also locally isomorphic and given by this Darboux normal form. And there is another kind of stability, global stability. So if you there is no kind of deformation of context structure on closed manifold or deformation on manifold non-compact, but say with a compact support. So the any such deformation is just an isotopy. So I will, again, that's a contact manifold, but my interest in this talk will be just three-dimensional. So I will talking about three-dimensional contact manifold. In three-dimensional, we have a three space and we have a just two-dimensional plane field. And like one feature of contact plane field that it gives you orientation of the manifold because the sign of the form alpha HD alpha is independent of the sign of form alpha. So it gives you canonical orientation. So if the manifold already oriented, you can kind of talk about positive negative contact structure. And again, just to kind of rule out all kind of ambiguity in what I'm saying, I will only assume that I'm talking about positive contact structure on oriented manifold. So as I already kind of alluded to that, there is in general in contact geometry in all dimension, there exists some important dichotomy on contact structure which called overtwisted and contact structure called tight. So it's a two complementary classes. And this is like a certain number of component of the space of contact structure consists of tight and so certain number of overtwisted. This overtwisted contact structure, they in some sense not really, well, they're pure homotopy theoretical creatures. So they just like, they are kind of too flexible to have any kind of rich symplectic geometry. And so like everything essentially, well, there are some interesting question about overtwisted contact structure, but mainly problem of twisted contact structure is essentially homotopy theoretical. For instance, classification on closed manifold is the same as just classification of, say, what is called almost contact structure. For instance, for three-dimensional plane case, it's just classification of two plane field up to homotopy. So, but complementary classes tight, that's what kind of like all symplectic rigidity reside, and that's a main interest. So just again, this notion exists in any dimension, but I only talk in three-dimensional case. So therefore, I only define in three-dimensional. So this, again, condition means twisting. So you can always find like affiliate locally, say, our space by lines tangent to contact structure, so-called Legendrian filiation. Like, and then in terms of this Legendrian filiation, contact condition just means that our plane rotate as we in consistently in the same direction as we go tangent to each Legendrian leaf. So because this filiation just, we can take say any slice, and this filiation allows us to bring any other slice to this one, and then kind of like pulling back by flow along this filiation, we just see that intersection of plane with given transverse plane, or some lines, they always rotate in the given dimension. So this is a picture, just kind of like, there is some bad picture in my talk, which I draw. There's a good picture, which I took from internet, and most of them from Patrick Massot. He has a kind of posted some great picture. So this is a, on the left, this is a kind of context structure, which is just given by say form D, like this canonical form dz plus y dx. And there is an equivalent contact structure, which means diffeomorphic, but it can be given by contact form dz plus r squared d phi in contact coordinate, and then in cylindrical coordinate, and then kind of like picture look like this. So over-twisted contact structures, the word over-twisted means that they twist more than necessary, kind of like so. So for instance, like you, if you consider contact form this cosine in cylindrical contact cosine r dz plus r sine r d phi, then what we see, we have a family of planes which rotate, and at some moment this plane again become horizontal. And at this moment, if I take a, for instance, for this contact structure, if I take a disk, a horizontal disk of radius pi, then what I will see that the boundary of this disk is a Legendrian curve, is tangent to contact structure, tangent to contact structure. And this is a just precisely definition of overtwisting, contact structure called overtwisted, if you can find disk two dimensional, which along the boundary is tangent to contact structure. That's a, so of course, whether it's tangent, you can also say it's transverse to contact structure, because I slightly can kind of bend it along the boundary transverse. The important thing that it's not rotate contact structure and tangent plane field to the disk. They, with respect to each other, there is no rotation. That's kind of feature of over-twisted contact structure. So tightness means that such disks not exist. And it's not easy to check tightness. Why tight structure in this and this? Maybe any contact structure in principle have such disk you can find. And so there's kind of like this problem that the tight contact structure exists, do exist. Was first discovered. Well, he didn't have this word, but kind of was discovered by Daniel Benneken in 83. He proved that standard contact structure on R3 is tight, meaning that it does not admit this disk which I said. So it was actually kind of like before Benneken, it was certain conjecture that such thing does not exist, and there were some prior attempt to prove it, but that's proven by Daniel Benneken. And since that time, we know kind of many other completely different proof than what Daniel did. Some kind of best proof use serial holomorphic curve and based on kind of like, okay. So this is kind of symplectic rigidity statement. This is the fact that standard contact structure on R3 is tight. So it's kind of interesting that this statement holds kind of both. You can talk about, for instance, isomorphism of contact structure via some any diffeomorphism and just, so this is a kind of theorem which I proved in which says that up to diffeomorphism, there exists only one tight contact structure on R3, and this is a standard one. And this statement holds in kind of like, you can talk about, say, contact structure without any kind of control at infinity, and then this is true, but diffeomorphism, of course, you cannot have a control of diffeomorphism at infinity. Or you can say this is contact structure standard at infinity, and then this diffeomorphism can be chosen identity at infinity. So this theorem which I going to talk today is a generalization of the theorem the saying that, I will not discuss how this non-standard at infinity case can be reduced to standard one. This is a kind of separate matter. So just let's concentrate on contact structure which are standard at infinity. And I want to prove that the space of this contractible. So this previous statement, you can say this is just kind of one parametric or version of this, or zero parametric, depending how you count, because it just says that if you take any contact structure, if you can find homotopy in the class of contact structure, which between this contact structure and standard, that by this like Moser gray type stability, which I told you, that means that this homotopy can be realized by isotopy. And therefore, this contact structure is diffeomorphic to standard one via diffeomorphism, which is even isotopic to identity. So, any question kind of so far? Okay, well, I didn't say much, so. So this is like multi-parametric generalization of the previous statement, that if you take any family of this contact structure, then the whole family can be kind of simultaneously standardized. So, of course, this first statement, first claim said that the group of diffeomorphism acts transitively, like this non-parametric theorem said, implies that the group of diffeomorphism acts transitively on the space of tight contact structure. And there is an obvious kind of Serre fibration, which is given by a evaluation map, and this fibration of the group of diffeomorphism over space of tight contact structure, and the fiber is a precisely group of diffeomorphism which stabilizes standard contact structure. It's a group of contactomorphism of standard structure. And we know, so the statement about contractibility of this space of tight contact structure just means that group of contactomorphism and group of diffeomorphism are homotopy equivalent, which is kind of equivalent. And we know Hatcher proves that this group, in fact, of diffeomorphism, in fact, contractible. So this implies a group of contactomorphism, therefore, of the standard contact structure is also contractible. So that's kind of equivalent reformulation of this parametric claim. So I just kind of want to note that for me, just one of the motivation of thinking about this was a desire to have maybe some alternative proof of Hatcher theorem for diffeomorphism of R3. So this is a kind of great theorem, and the proof is very complicated, and kind of, as far as I understand, kind of not many people really understand all the details of this, and kind of like, for instance, I was not able to completely follow this proof. So I would very much like to have a proof which kind of like somehow based on some different ideas. And I saw that maybe via kind of like proving the contractibility of contactomorphism, could be easy, and so that would be give an alternative proof of Hatchell's theorem. But so far this is didn't realize. So the best that I kind of could do in this direction to prove that like very kind of like some version of SERF theorem, which says that if you take a say diffeomorphism of sphere, then it's extend to the ball. So this you can prove using contact structure without any kind of like contact topology, without any four-dimensional topology, any kind of topology, any but without Hatchell theorem. Because Hatchell theorem, of course, implies that because it just says that any diffeomorphism of S3 is isotopic to identities, therefore it extends. Okay, well, but this is a kind of side remark. Okay, so the proof is based on what kind of Giroux was calling contact tomography. So that means that we just consider family of surfaces in contact manifold and analyze how our contact structure intersect with the surfaces. So this contact tomography was not kind of invented by Giroux. It was actually used by Beneken and his original work, and I also used it in my original proof of the theorem, which I said. But since that time, Emmanuel Giroux and kind of later Co-Honda, they introduced kind of technique of what is called contact convexity. So this notion was introduced in our paper with Gromov, but we didn't really do anything with it. And Emmanuel really pushed it quite far. And kind of like, in particular, this convex surface series allows to have some kind of alternative, probably simpler proof of my theorem. But I have no idea how to do this contact surface theory in this multi-parametric case, at least. I cannot do that. And it's my understanding that other people who tried it also could not do that. So I'm continue to work in the framework of what I did in original proof, not using this. So as I said, this kind of will be based on understanding what is called characteristic relation of surfaces. So if you have a contact structure and you have a surface, you just intersect and you get just one-dimensional line field, which is integrable. And of course, but it may have a singularity where our contact plane tangent to the surface. So for instance, for like round sphere and standard contact structure in R3, you would see this picture of this characteristic relation. And again, this is a token from internet, and this is a by Davide Barilari, this beautiful picture. And what you see is that this filiation from topological point of view is just from diffeomorphism point of view, there is some kind of spiral, and so there is a kind of some subtle behavior at singular point. But from topological point, this is just a kind of like sink. So just it's just that. And in fact, I'll explain, for all purposes, the smooth topology, so I will be studying this singularity of this map and this filiation, and smooth topology of singularity and smooth topology of filiation will be completely irrelevant. So the only thing which be relevant is just non-smooth topology, just it's a homeomorphism type of the singularity. And generically, in generic case, if they non-degenerate, they could be just elliptic called, and this elliptic, well, it just meaning just index plus or minus one of this vector field, elliptic hyperbolic. And again, they also can be divided into positive or negative, because contact plane oriented, we can assume, and surface oriented, therefore kind of you can orient also characteristic filiation. And it's a, of course, question of convention, but we oriented always the same, this following way, that that this elliptic, positive elliptic are always sources, negative elliptic always sinks. And hyperbolic, of course, hyperbolic, but you should not be kind of fooled by this picture, because this, though it is a kind of look like standard hyperbolic, it's not diffeomorphic to like hyperbolic in the sense of like xy equal constant Fourierization. It's a, in fact, it's diffeomorphic to Fourierization xy to the some exponent alpha equal to constant, and this alpha cannot be equal to one, otherwise it's not non-integral. But again, but for me, because I'm only talking about topology, not smooth topology, then this is just standard. So in one parametric family could be what I call embryo. So it's a kind of moment where two critical points, hyperbolic and elliptic, get born. And then at this moment, topology look like point half elliptic, half hyperbolic. On one side, it kind of look like hyperbolic, on other side is elliptic. And again, from the point of view, so I call such point embryos. So I would have to consider them as well. So no, I would not need any more complicated singularities, but I have to consider elliptic and hyperbolic point and embryos. And again, this embryos could be positive or could be negative. And that's kind of depending on this orientation of this relation. So as I said, there is a kind of standard fact in contact topology that characteristic relation is in fact determine completely contact structure on the neighborhood of the surface. So if we have a two contact structure which kind of cut on the surface the same characteristic relation, then they are diffeomorphic. We are diffeomorphic the identity on the surface. So in some sense, this characteristic relation completely determine contact structure in its neighborhood. And for instance, it determine, you can just judging only topology of characteristic relation, you're able to understand if it's tight or not. You can just ask, look at this relation. Is it contact structure in the neighborhood? Is it tight or not? So this is just, you can look at the, understand from the topology of this relation. So again, in general, of course, singularity could be terrible if you can consider general thing, but I will call this characteristic relation Morse if all singular points are non-degenerate, and generalized Morse if in addition it may have some embryo points. So just there is this corresponding terminology in the theory of critical point of function in Morse theory. You have a Morse function and this generalized Morse function, or which are kind of generic for one parametric family of functions. So in the space of in the world of function, there exists this famous result called Igusa theorem, this is Kyosho Igusa, and which is said that like there is some H principle kind of type kind of question which say that kind of if by some formal reason high singularity not necessary in this family of functions, then you can in fact get rid of them. And analog what so Igusa proved this theorem kind of with some constraint on dimension up to certain dimension, and then we prove it with Mishachov in general case. And this is a like adjustment of our proof in function also work in this situation, and you can prove the following result. So suppose, and I will be only, of course, more general, but for my purposes, the following. So let's suppose you're given any family of contact structure on the neighborhood of two spheres and parameterized by some, any family parameterized by some compact space. And for some closed subset of this space of parameter, we know the characteristic relation is standard. And by standard, I would just mean the one on this picture, which means that we have just two elliptic points and all trajectory go from one elliptic point to another elliptic point. So for run spaces, it's standard, and for other things, I just don't know, it can be terrible. Then by C0 small isotopy of this sphere in its neighborhood, you can achieve, you can make all characteristic relation generalized Morse. So that means that if you kind of like, if you have a freedom to change your family by any family, any parametric family, by C0 isotopy, and you can on the boundary, I didn't say it, but it should be added that for the value of parameter when it is already standard, you don't need to change it. So therefore, this is like key, in some sense, key point, because I mean, key technical point, because it allows to work just with the generalized Morse relation. Otherwise, you would not be able to understand anything.
Maybe I'm missing something. So the condition is on some closed subset of K, right? And then the statement is about the whole of K.
Yeah, whole of K. I forgot to write it down. That for T in A, this AHTS is in fact identity.
No, but maybe I get confused. What if I don't know? K is disconnected and A is contained in one connected component.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. So this kind of relative result. So because if, mm-hmm. for instance, suppose there is no A, mm-hmm. then you can just perturb it all of them to Morse. Kind of the meaning of this A is that if it's already somewhere standard, you do not need to change it there.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's only kind of meaning. So if there is some component of K which kind of have nothing to do with this A, then you just perturb it there without it even easy. So this is an extra condition, not.
Okay, so mentioning A is just misleading.
No, it's not misleading, because like my main actually interest is the following, that you have our K is a disk of some dimension, and A is a boundary. Mm-hmm. And this is a boundary. And so you have some family parameterized by disk, but on the boundary, it's already standard. But inside, it's kind of terrible. Then you can perturb the whole this relation, keep it on the boundary and change such that it become everywhere generalized Morse.
Okay, thank you.
So Yasha, I have a question.
Yes.
So, I mean, ideally you want to extend it so that it's standard, right? You cannot do it, so this is a little bit less. Is that?
Yeah, I would like to. Yes, to extend it to so this statement for any context structure kind of does not say that it's tight or not tight or anything. So it's just completely universal statement. And in this context, it's just not true that you can make it standard for all value parameter.
Okay, thank you.
And you can make a generalized Morse, but indeed, kind of a posteriori from whatever I prove, it follows that in fact, if it's tight, I know that it's the family is tight, that you can make them standard for all parameter. But this is already kind of hard theorem, and this is not so.
Generalized Morse is with the singularities, right? You described.
Yeah, generalized Morse, that means that some embryos appear and the nuclear critical okay. point kind of pair appear, disappear, kind of like whatever.
Thanks.
So kind of like all bifurcation happen as if it were like one dimensional family. So there is a kind of like, let me tell you a couple words about some, again, standard contact geometric things. So let's consider closed surface in the context remanifold, or surface which bounds a transverse to context structure curve. And then we can denote by E plus minus the numbers of elliptic and hyperbolic point positive or negative on surface. And then we consider this kind of signature thing, D plus minus, or just E plus minus minus H plus minus. So, and I assume that my characteristic relation is oriented in such a way that it's an outward transverse to the boundary if the boundary is not empty. So then there is this kind of pure simple kind of topology which says that this sum of this D plus and D minus, this is the earlier characteristic, this is essentially Hopf theorem, and D plus minus D minus is a Chern class. So, or you can say Euler class. So if in the case of the boundary, this is an abstraction for extending this transverse vector field as a tangent vector field to the contact plane field. And out of this formula, it just of course follows that D plus D minus you can express through this Chern number and Euler characteristic. In particular, for S2 in R3, if you have a contact structure in R3, then of course Chern class is trivial. So then we get this, oh, sorry, we get, sorry. We get D plus minus is equal to one. So there is a very kind of important tool in contact geometry called, I call it Giroux-Fuchs elimination lemma. Sometimes people call it Giroux elimination lemma. So it was proposed by Giroux, but with some kind of extra condition, and then Fuchs kind of removes this condition. And it just said the following thing, like, of course, we can always, it's always easy by just C0 perturbation of surface to create two new critical points. So it's like make embryo and then create pair elliptic hyperbolic point. But then it turns out that converse is also true. That if you have a pair of elliptic and hyperbolic point of the same sign, which connected by trajectory of characteristic relation, then you can, by C0 isotopy, you can change this characteristic relation to kill this critical point. So this is a kind of like, it's almost obvious. So if you just think about this, so what it means, right? So you have this, our contact plane field and somewhere it's tangent to surface, but then you continue along this characteristic, it start to rotate, but then in come back because it's tangent with the same sign. So it's kind of, it's not flip, but it come back. And so therefore what you can do, so instead of like you think about this kind of coordinate system where the plane is not moving, but instead of you rotate your surface in the neighborhood to make it transfer. So anyway, so this is a, if you think about this, it's not a hard theory, kind of like originally when it was developed, it was not kind of obvious immediately to people that such thing holds because in in topology, usually for more theory, people try to kill critical point along transverse curve, but here, to level set. And here you're killing it along tangent. So it follows from here some claim. So I will go quickly. So my time actually is going very slow. So so let me kind of slightly accelerate. So you can prove the following thing, that suppose there exists disk with boundary transverse outward and such that D plus is equal to one. And then this Euler characteristic formula immediately tell me that D minus is equal to zero. And then all critical point except all critical point except just one positive point could be eliminated. Why? Because you have this disk, and you have this, suppose you have some hyperbolic point, positive hyperbolic point. Then this positive, if you take a positive hyperbolic point, then for this positive hyperbolic point, you can consider its incoming separatrix. So this is elliptic point, and the separatrix should come generically from some positive elliptic point, and then you can kill them. So you can kill all hyperbolic point, and then you can also kill all negative point, because if for negative hyperbolic point all separatrices go to the boundary, if it go to negative elliptic point, then we can like outgoing separatrices will go to the boundary, then it forced to have so then this arc divide our disk, and each part have to have an elliptic point, because it have to have this kind of source in there. And so therefore this is not possible, because you have a plus, because you already killed all elliptic point by one, by our assumption, and therefore this is not possible, and hence you can kill also hyperbolic point. And it also follows that for annulus with d plus equal one, all point except one positive elliptic and one negative hyperbolic could be eliminated. So also kind of like important kind of for technical for application lemma is the following, which follows from this, that suppose you have a sphere and you have an annulus in the sphere. And suppose for this annulus, you know that d plus is equal to one. Then you can show that for every disk, for instance, if you take this disk bounded by any boundary component of this annulus, d plus is also one. And therefore, all critical point except one elliptic point can be eliminated. Okay, it just follows again exactly from what I said above. Okay. So now let me kind of like have this digression into pure topology. So now you can forget about anything about contact structure. There's just like for next 3 minutes, contact structure completely irrelevant. So we're just studying functions on spheres, on two-dimensional spheres and balls. So most function on this one. So first of all, I start with a function on the ball. So I said, so suppose you have a function on the ball, and suppose this function have no critical point on the ball, but on the boundary, this is this Morse or generalized Morse function. Suppose you have such function. And then this function, I call it simple. If you take any level set and any kind of connected component of the level set, then this connected component of level set is contractible. So it's kind of look like tree kind of disk kind of connected like in this picture. So I call such function simple. So this is simple function and this is non-simple function. You see that you have some level set which is not contractible here. You kind of have some annular and this kind. So this is a right. So the question, can I characterize functions which arise as a restriction of simple function on the ball? Can I characterize function on sphere which can be, which have this property that they are like boundary value of the such simple function? And then it turns out that there exists pure intrinsic definition. It's a, so let's suppose now you have a function, let's say you have a function only on sphere, so forget about the ball. So then for every so I will consider hyperbolic point, and I will call hyperbolic point positive if when I take, if I take say nearby level kind of regular level below this thing, and I consider they, I take for some gradient vector field, I consider the trajectory that they end up on the same component, on the same component. And if in this picture, if if they land up this on different component, I call it negative. So this is a positive hyperbolic point in this definition, and this is a negative hyperbolic point. And then you can do the following construction. For every you just can consider for every critical level, you consider take some level slightly below, and consider for all positive hyperbolic point, you just can consider corresponding separatrix, and you consider the following graph, for which this is just a vertices, all this component of vertices, and all this all this kind of stable manifold or hyperbolic positive hyperbolic points are edges. So we call function simple. So this is a graph, and more or less a ribbon graph, because there is a at every vertex there is some order of vertices, and coming from this orientation of the circle, and we call function simple if every if this graph on every level consists of union of trees. And then this kind of like pretty simple but not completely trivial. Okay, so we also have to talk about embryos, but let me kind of ignore it for a second. And so we call so the theorem that function is simple if and only function phi is a restriction is a so function phi so phi is a restriction of a simple function on the ball if and only if for every critical level this graph is a union of trees. So you can completely characterize this restriction of simple function by this property. And moreover, this is true parametrically, that any family of simple function on sphere kind of satisfies this property extend to a family of simple function on the ball. So this is a not completely trivial, but it's more or less straightforward just topology of like three-dimensional topology. Okay, so what does simple function have to do with context structure? So now suppose we have the sphere, and I have a characteristic relation. And I take this characteristic relation and I orient it. I choose on this characteristic relation some vector field orienting it. And function phi I call taming function, function phi tame f. If, first of all, it's kind of Lyapunov function for this vector field, that means that vector field is gradient lying for this function. And positive and negative singular point of filiation are positive and negative critical points of function in the sense, as I said before. And kind of like not hard to prove that if it's tamed tight filiation, that this function is in fact automatically taming function, automatically simple. And this is a kind of key point in the whole proof. which says filiation is tight if and only if it admits a simple taming function. So this is a kind of some new statement in kind of three-dimensional contact topology. So usually kind of people use theory of convex surfaces, and but not every surface is convex. And there is a Giroux characterization when this on convex surface when it is tight. But there is no, as far as I know, this characterization of tight filiation in general case when the surface is not convex, and that's it. So it's a convex if and only if it admits a simple taming function. And kind of moreover, there is this, you can prove a parametric version of this, that any family of tight filiation admits a family of simple taming function. So in fact, to prove that from existence of taming function implied tightness, it's an easy thing. And hard part is to proving that if you have a tight filiation, then it admits such taming function. Okay, so maybe let me, I'm almost out of time. I still want to at least hint how to prove goals of the statement. So let me explain how this now help to prove original theorem, how all the statement help to prove the theorem. So there is a case, the following statement, which is a kind of not hard, which says that if you have a characteristic filiation together with a taming function extended to the ball, this allows you to canonically extend your filiation to contact structure on the ball. So this extension of taming function as a function, a simple function to the ball, allow you to construct extension of contact structure, and it's homotopically canonical in a sense that it works for any family. So this can be done. This is a not hard point. So kind of like, maybe let me explain you trivial case. For instance, if you have a just standard filiation, and then kind of there's this function, and then there is a kind of like, we already seen this standard picture, kind of propeller type picture, which extending to this contact structure to this ball. And so for every simple function, you can do something like this. Or there is alternative proof using some kind of a little bit of complex geometry and some construction of pseudo-convex surfaces. But anyway, this is not a hard theory. And now the theorem, like main theorem out of all this proposition, is proven just as follows. So you take you have a family of contact structure standard at infinity. So you just take a big ball and you filiate this ball by spheres. So if the sphere is small, then characteristic filiation on them is standard. On the big one is also standard. By kind of Igusa type claim, you can perturb all the sphere to make them characteristic filiation generalized Morse. And by the theorem, each of this filiation admit taming function, simple taming function. And this taming function allows you to extend our filiation to contact structure on this ball. So we start with this thing and just construct this canonical extension. Then you take slightly smaller sphere, you take contact structure which you have and extend canonically. And finally, you go to very small sphere, you take the contact structure which you have, extend canonically, but here it, because already standard, will be standard extension. So at the end, you have a contact structure you started with, and at the beginning, you have a standard contact structure, and therefore you constructed homotopy, and this will give you isotopy. And this works, as I said, in any family, so it's a proof contractibility. So the whole kind of essence is just proof of this statement. So everything is, so this parametric version is not really kind of very, very easy. And so like out of this one. So the main thing is just to prove this characterization of tightness and to show that if you have a tight foliation, then it admit the stemming function. So let me just explain kind of the following thing. So first of all, so to prove this proposition, it is always sufficient to prove just the following statement. So suppose you have this kind of characteristic foliation and you have this elliptic point. And suppose you already managed to construct, not managed, but suppose you have a function which is like have a minimum in all elliptic positive points. Then suppose you can prove that you can always find either embryo or hyperbolic point positive elliptic such that you can extend to this function over this point in such a way that kind of like new function preserves the simplicity condition. So that means that for instance, if you have a negative point for critical foliation, then you must have a kind of one component kind of divided if it's of level set, otherwise two component joined. So, but because then you can, by induction, you can consider. So now let's kind of talk a little bit about topology. Okay, so now I should kind of ask organizer. I am, of course, already out of time. Yes? Or I still have a little bit of time to go.
No, you have, what is it? Four more minutes, almost five more minutes.
Almost 5 minutes, okay, great.
And I can quote Anton also to say that it's 5 minutes, which is negotiable.
let me not waste time in negotiation. Okay. So what I'm kind of going to do is the following. So let's kind of understand topology of foliation. So let's consider the following object. Let's take we know it's a tight foliation. There is no say limit cycle. There is no closed leaf. So let's take for every hyperbolic point, let's consider unstable separatrices of this point, and also for embryo, if you have an embryo. And this embryo also may have some unstable separatrices. You also kind of include them. And then let sigma will be the union of all unstable separatrices of all hyperbolic point. Then I claim if you remove the sigma, then the complement consists of disk, and each disk have a unique positive elliptic point, and it just filled by, like in this picture, it's filled by trajectories emanating from this elliptic point. So every component of the complement of sigma of this kind of, let's call it discriminant set is a union of disks which are basins of a positive elliptic point. This is a kind of like standard fact from two-dimensional topology. And so now what I see on the boundary. So let's take one of this basin. And what I see on the boundary? On the boundary, I can see elliptic. So let's just consider the like case when there is no embryo, like generic case, no embryo, and there is only hyperbolic point, elliptic, there's only hyperbolic and elliptic point. And also, let's assume just for a second, this is a terrible assumption, but it's a generic assumption. Let's assume there is no homoclinic connection. So in this case, every basin has a very standard structure. It has a like it has some boundary of this basin. It has some corners. And on each edge, there is this unique hyperbolic point, which can be elliptic or hyper, which can be, hyperbolic point, which can be positive or negative. And like it's a Manet trajectory, which go to this negative elliptic corners. And if I manage to find positive elliptic, positive hyperbolic point, which adjacent to two different basins, then I won, because that's exactly allow me to do this extension. So if this coming from some other positive elliptic point, then I have a function defined here. And there is a kind of standard extension. I think I have it on some picture like this. I have a standard extension over this hyperbolic point, and this kind of like one step. So similarly, if I have a negative hyperbolic point, which is on the boundary from two sides on the boundary of the same basin, then again, I can extend it because this again, this is allowable extension. So the whole game is to prove that there are kind of at every moment, there is this like either there is a hyperbolic positive elliptic point kind of, which I call allowable. So that you can extend over it, or there are allowable embryos. So there is also embryos with this property over, they can be kind of swallowed by the level set of function. And the game always is the following, that like why for instance in non-degenerate case, why you always can find it? So let's take a boundary of every basin, of any basin. If on the boundary of this basin, you always must have on the boundary of basin, always must have some of what I call pseudovertices, this kind of hyperbolic point in the middle of sites. So because it's just simple topology, because all corners are just sinks, so somewhere should be sources. So should be this hyperbolic point. And if there is no identified kind of negative, no identified negative pseudovertices, and there is no, and positive pseudovertices, it cannot be, so the kind of key point, the positive hyperbolic point cannot lie on the boundary of the same basin, because otherwise I would get this loop, which just have a elliptic point and hyperbolic point of the same sign, and I could kill them, and I get a contradiction with tightness. And so, and then if on the boundary of the basin, you don't see any negative, any identified hyperbolic point, and there is no positive hyperbolic point at all, then again, going along the boundary, I get some loop, which again contradicts the tightness. And so this is a kind of like a trivial case, and which is essentially kind of written in my original paper. And but then this kind of general case, kind of like a little bit more complicated, but there are some kind of like few levels of induction over a number of homoclinics, which kind of like prove this theorem. So I don't have any possibility to extend it. If somebody asks me a question, I can give to
Misha, I have a simple question about simple functions.
Yes.
So you said functional simple if a critical level set is a graph, right?
Yes. For
but both. In your picture, I'm remembering your earlier picture with some yellow color in it. There were two pictures, one simple, the other non-simple, earlier. The critical level.
It's not a graph. It's not graph.
Visual circles.
Not graph, but tree.
Oh, I see tree. Okay. Thank you. Okay. I'm comfortable now.
So I mean, this just in the for the bool, the simplicity condition just means that every level set is just so. You just cannot, for instance, have this picture like this. So you cannot have a like disk which kind of bite itself.
But okay. Thanks a lot. That clarifies.
Thanks a lot. Any questions or comments? So you can either raise your electronic hand or just unmute and ask a question.
I was hoping that somebody would ask me a question how to prove some demo.
Give some details.
Absolutely, we'll come to it. But okay, yeah. If there are no at the moment other questions, please do tell us about the ideas of the proof.
Okay, so now kind of like my talk is ended, and so therefore everybody of course kind of welcome to leave.
Welcome to stay, right?
Yes. Okay. so again, maybe let me kind of like at least to prove something definitely kind of not waving hand. Let me at least consider this proof of. Let me prove something. Okay, so let's just prove just kind of as I already said. So existence of taming. So I define this notion of say allowable. So again, what is pseudo vertex? So if you have a basin, and if on the boundary of this basin you see this picture, you have some hyperbolic point, and it kind of there is a center of this basin, and it's connected by trajectory to this point. So I call this point pseudo vertex. So then, kind of like near this point, picture of characteristic filiation is like this. So now there is a notion of allowable pseudo vertices. So I said pseudo vertex, positive pseudo vertex is allowable if it is a pseudo vertex for two adjacent basin, different basins. So that means that incoming separatrices to this point coming from two different elliptic poles. And allowable negative pseudo vertex, that means that there is a hyperbolic point such that both trajectory come from the same elliptic pole. So as I explained, as soon as I found such H, then I can extend this function over neighborhood of this point, and then I kind of continue the game. So there is also embryo, but let's kind of like for simplicity forget about embryo. They kind of complicate the whole picture, but suppose there is no embryo, let's assume that. So then kind of like, again, the whole theorem just means this, that existence, just this proposition, there is always an allowable pseudo-versus or embryo. So if I can prove that, that's it. So this I will be proving by induction of the total number of homoclinic orbit and embryos. So let's consider the base case. So base case, there are no embryos. There's a base of induction. So take any basin. So and look at the boundary. What could happen? So boundary could be, it may happen that boundary is just doubly covered tree. Like think about this. There is only one elliptic point positive, and kind of everything converge to just kind of, if you consider union of these trajectories, that complement you just consider is just tree, and this tree is kind of automatically doubly covered, kind of like as a boundary. So,
doubly covered, which means that to each point there are two trajectories leading from
each trajectory, right? So if I can think about this basis as a just abstract polygon mapped to our sphere, and in this case I see two different sides of this polygon mapped to the same edge of this graph. So it could be doubly covered thing. But then if it doubly covered things, then of course each such edge of this tree contain the pseudo vertex, and by definition it's allowable, so we are done. So suppose now it's not, it is not doubly covered tree. And then if it's not doubly covered tree, it have to contain non-trivial embedded loop. And suppose there is no positive pseudo vertices at all. As I said, any positive pseudo vertices, so any positive pseudo vertex in this case always automatically allowable because there is no homoclinic. So therefore trajectory coming from elliptic point, and they cannot come from the same point because otherwise it contradicts tightness. So then we would get some loop, and this loop contain no positive hyperbolic point, and you can assume that this loop, so the all kind of point on the on them are negative hyperbolic, and it's embedded because there is no identified vertices, and therefore again, and this is contradict tightness because this kind of, then you have a, like you started and you kind of start killing pairs of these points, and eventually you get a limit cycle. So this proof basic case. Now let's kind of like prove first non-trivial case when you have just one homoclinic. Again, like forget about embryo. Let's suppose you have one homoclinic, and then I want to prove in this case. So I don't know what I read. I think so. I think it's the same thing I said. This is a positive embryo. Let's just consider. Let's just consider again all this thing about a membrane. Suppose you have a homoclinic. If you have one homoclinic, then you have the following picture. So you have like one hyperbolic point. There is this unstable separatrices inside our discriminant set, and there is one incoming separatrice from hyperbolic point. So in this case, you have like three basins which could be the same. On three sides, T1, T2, and T3. So suppose T1 is the same as T2, then this H1 have to be negative, as I said, and therefore it's allowable. So we can assume, therefore, T1 is not T2. Now, suppose T1 is kind of equal to T3, for instance, or just so what I just want to conclude that all of them distinct, but suppose T1 say equal to T3, then you can do the following thing. You can just by C infinity small perturbation, you can kind of deviate the separatrices kind of, so it would be go either to the left or to the right. So suppose I change it and I get this following picture. So now you came to the previous case. So this one is this picture is then this this point. So now you don't have any homoclinic, and then now therefore I know that there exists allowable vertex. But this allowable vertex could be this H2. But if T1, if say T3 equal T1, if T3 equal T1, then like looking at this resolution, if this is allowable, it has to be negative. But because T1 is not T2 and T2 is not T3, when I resolve this one, if this is allowable, therefore H2 have to be positive. So that means that at least for one of these cases, allowable vertex is somewhere else, and therefore it existed even before I made this resolution. So, okay, so, but now, okay. By some reason I didn't write. Okay. So now what we get. So therefore, T1. What we conclude that this in this case all this T1, T2, and T3 have to be different. But then, if this is the case, then I can do the following thing. I take a. Let's consider this basin. And again, this basin must have some homoclinic. Because kind of, as I explained, any basin must have a, not homoclinic, must have a, some pseudo-vertex. Because if it does not have, then again, you get the contradiction to tightness. And this pseudo-vertex cannot be the same as H2. In principle, it could be, but because T3 is not T2, then it's a different, and again, we are done. Okay, so I probably don't want to go. Okay.
Yeah, but that's the picture that you were drawing again, right? This one, where
yes, you have H3. Yeah, so yes, so I draw, yes. Okay, and, okay, and then this kind of like general induction case look like this. So I kind of gradually remove all these things. So first I'm proving that, okay, so if there exists positive embryo, then you can deduce this thing. Okay, so there are some arguments. And also if you have a configuration, like let me for instance, look at this one. So I claim this configuration like all cannot happen. Because again, kind of similar argument, if this has happened, then you can resolve this separatrix. And this would be already by induction previous case. And therefore there exists some pseudo-vertex. And this pseudo-vertex cannot be, now we got kind of only extra new point, but this pseudo-vertex is not allowable. So therefore it's not this one. So hence it's somewhere else. And all of them like this, and kind of at the end, final thing, when you can rule out everything by this kind of reduction to previous case, you just get that then it have to be overtwisted. Kind of you get some loop and then have to be overtwisted. Okay, well, I think probably I cannot kind of really honestly give proof within less than maybe an hour. So that.
Okay, thanks a lot. Any further questions or comments?
Maybe I have a question. I mean, so I didn't follow everything you said, Yasha, so maybe it's a stupid question. But I mean, for instance, here you were taking kind of like a homoclinic orbit or so, and you resolve it to one side. But when you're doing like parametric families, right, like somehow this may be like unavoidable to move it to one side in the family.
Right. So here's the kind of like beauty of what we do. So this statement is the following, that it's sufficient to consider non-parametric case. So maybe I should explain this. So suppose I can take any such characteristic relation, and I cannot assume it generic, so it has any number of homoclinic or anything, but just individual relation. And suppose for this one, I found a function, taming function. Then it's automatically just by, this is an open condition taming function. So it's automatically remain taming function for a neighborhood of this relation. And then if you have now the following property, suppose you consider space of taming function for a fixed relation. And the space of taming function for a fixed relation is convex. So kind of like if you consider linear combination of taming function for the same relation, it remains taming function. So taming condition kind of obviously, so that means the derivative along this vector field is positive, is survive convexity. So simplicity condition is kind of need to be checked, but it's also thanks to tightness, it survives this thing. And therefore, because you're just covered by this neighborhood and on intersection kind of this adjustment, this you have a contractible adjustment, so you always can glue them.
Okay, yeah, thanks a lot.
Yeah, so that's kind of course main point. Yeah. Otherwise, kind of, it would be impossible.
No, I see.
Yes, sir. What is the set of all tight contact structures look like inside of all contact structures? What's the topology of that? Since they are compact, I mean, they must.
No, but the space of tight contact structure is topologically, it's contractible. So what do you mean?
Oh, it is. Oh.
It's contractible. So it's not.
So, I was hoping some.
But yeah. It's just for R3. It's just for R3. Of course, you know that if you can consider like more complicated menu. R3, like for S, it follows that on S3, it has a topology of that unitary group.
Okay.
You have
I was hoping but, like picture, like Donaldson's picture, when he gets invariants, you know, space of some special, some subsets of special, you know.
Yeah. So of course, it kind of would be interesting to understand spaces of tight contact structure and other manifold. But that's what actually, friend process is doing. So I'm not exactly kind of understand his work, but kind of like, but he kind of like his students, they claiming that kind of like based on this result, they can essentially understand topology for any space of tight contact structure for topology of connected components, not like they, of course, we don't know classification of tight contact structure, but they claim that topology they have somehow answer, but I don't know.
So maybe this is the homology clause of that compact object inside of set of all compact contact structures. This can be non-trivial, whatever can be studied, right? As a homology clause.
Yeah, but it's always connected, the number of connected components. So, kind of like, you see that kind of like, if you take two contact structure homotopic, so that's the same. So that means that the tight contact structure form always kind of connected component, a bunch of
connected, but components. I mean, space of contact structures has some topology, right? It has some homology group in it.
Yeah, but it's first of all disconnected, right?
It's connected, okay.
But in every connected components, it's all of them either tight or over twisted. If it's...
Yasha, I'm still about R3, but if it is over twisted, then is it contractible as well for over twisted case in R3?
For over twisted, yeah. So if you consider space of so this is actually kind of like in some sense easy, in some sense okay so here's a correct statement. Mm-hmm. Suppose you take you fixed one over twisted disk. And consider space of all over twisted context structure which are coincide with this disk, which fixed near this disk.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Over twisted for this disk.
Uh-huh. Yeah, on the neighborhood of the one disk. For instance, the case of R3, this. Space, so every connected component. Then the topology is the same as the topology of plane fields.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever it is, it's just topology of plane field fixed at one point.
Mm-hmm.
So if you like also fixed at infinity, so, okay, so it's essentially kind of like loop space of S2 or something like this.
But maybe there is another over twisted disk. So you say that that's reducible, but
this issue of the space. But then, if not, that you need to understand what the space of over twisted is. And again, Fran Presser somehow right claiming that he can prove some statement about this. But okay, but it's not. Mm. I don't know.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. I don't know. Are there any more questions or comments?
Yeah, sorry, Anton. Maybe another technical question for Yasha. So yeah, I was thinking about this. So this, you have like this IGUSA type theorem, right? That you said at the beginning. And it was not obvious to me. So I guess like when you're doing it not relative in the parameter, I see that there's no formal abstraction. You just choose kind of randomly and then, okay.
Yeah, you do
your wrinkling thing, I guess. But...
You absolutely kind of good question because what I was worried because if you a priori we don't know kind of homotopy type of plane field,
yeah,
that maybe there is a formal abstraction, but then kind of like what we realize that if it so I'm not claiming that this absolute statement just say provided that like on the boundary of this moduli space they already kind of figusa that I don't know the statement, but if you have a on the boundary there a standard.
Uh huh.
So then formal abstraction vanishes in this case.
Okay, I think I understand that, yes. So thanks. That's very good.
That's fine.
Right, any more questions or comments? If not, Yasha, thanks again for a great talk. Thank you everybody for participation. And next week it will be Nigel Hickson speaking at Global Poisson. So thanks a lot, everybody. Thank you, Yasha, and see you next week.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Yasha, maybe before you run away, when can we expect to read this? When is it going to be on the archive?
I okay. So I very.